So, but today we're going to talk about digital advertising. I've been in digital advertising for about 25 years now, since I was probably just a little bit older than you guys, in my mid-20s. I'm calling the lecture from Mad Men to Math Men, and that alludes to kind of the importance of math that's gotten involved in advertising. People don't realize that that's become kind of a central theme. So I'm gonna do an intro. We're gonna kind of set the stage, like what is digital advertising and compared to traditional advertising? What are some of the major shifts that have been happening over the past, I'd say, 20 years? A lot of them are gonna be, you guys will be familiar with. Some of them you will have just been born for them, but there's been a lot of like major changes. Some of the fundamentals, and then also looking at kind of what are some of the career paths. Like hopefully, you know, my goal for you guys out of this is just to kind of open your minds into, all right, what's possible as you're trying to figure out what you want to do with your lives and the direction you're planning on taking it. Digital advertising is a booming industry, and there's a lot of really interesting companies in LA that are growing, have lots of job opportunities, and I want to kind of try and break it down for you so you can understand what's happening behind the scenes when you see ads on your apps and on the internet, and then also leave you with some ideas, okay? And also throughout, feel free to ask questions, interrupt me if you have any ideas. I started in digital advertising in 1996. I was mid-20s, and I actually responded to an advertisement in the print version of the LA Times. AOL, at that point in time, was the internet. You know, you guys were, I don't know if you guys, who was born in 1996? Anybody? Okay. In that year? Or, okay. So you guys, like, the world as you guys know it did not exist at that time. Like the internet apps, the way that it was a totally different ball game. And I've spent my entire career kind of going through the shifts and the evolutions of digital advertising. Does anybody here ever know what the Whisper app is? Anybody ever heard of it? It's an anonymous social network. Yeah? Yeah, I worked therefore, yeah, it's a mobile app, and it's kind of an alternative to identity-based networks like Instagram and Snapchat and Facebook, where people know who you are. And so it's the idea is to create this space where you can post whatever you want, you know, whether you're going through a hard time or, you know, you just want some feedback. The challenge with it is that people can act like jerks, and so they're really grappling with it. But it's a noble app. It's got a great purpose, but it has not scaled yet. I was just curious. So let's talk about digital advertising. Digital compared to what? And that's basically traditional advertising. When you think about your traditional advertising channels, and just so you know, kind of how I talk, my perspective is from an advertiser or a marketer that's trying to drive sales or that's trying to create leads or get somebody to respond to an advertisement. And so historically, the vast majority of advertising revenue has been locked in what we call traditional channels, which you see every day. Billboards, radio, newspapers, television, and direct mail. But what's happened over the last 25 years is that the dollars are migrating to digital channels, such as social. You guys are familiar with all these, video on YouTube, search, and programmatic. And here's why. So why is this massive shift happening to the world if you're an advertiser? And I've circled it right here. And what we're looking at here, this is the share of ad spending by medium from 2014 to 2017. If you look at all these other mediums, they're basically forecasted to remain flat or decline, right? Newspapers scheduled to go down. Like, this is a dying industry, right? Outdoor, it's all even except mobile. And you guys know why. Where do you spend your lives? You know, each and every day, it's on your mobile phones, right? And so that's what's happening. The industry is not able to react like as quickly as the world changes. And so that's what's happening right now. The advertising industry is trying to catch up to make, to compensate for this big discrepancy in terms of where human beings are spending their time versus where the advertising dollars fall. This is another way to look at it. Digital mediums are the only ones that are forecasted to grow. TV is still remaining strong, but my point is that digital is where all the growth is happening. Here you see it's going from 2011, it was $32 billion a year. This is macro, going to $61 billion, massive growth. And what that means to you guys, who cares? You know, these are numbers. It means jobs. It means job opportunities. It means growth in this particular space. So these dollars are in flux. And there's a few reasons why. Two primary. One we already talked about. This is where people are spending their time, you know, on mobile devices, in apps. But the other reason is that digital advertising is measurable in ways that traditional advertising never was. This is a famous quote here. "Half the money I spend on advertising is wasted. The trouble is I don't know which half." So when you think about television advertising, radio, newspaper, those mediums, now these are, you know, big brands, big marketers. Think, you know, Nike, right? Nike's doing a big television campaign. They spend all this money. Do they know with a degree of certainty how much sales? What was the impact of that advertising? No, it's guesswork. And historically, in this industry, it's all been guesswork. Right? There's some, you know, they do hire, you know, fancy mathematicians to come up with models to say, all right, we think it worked. But by and large, it's been guesswork. And that's what is also driving the growth of this industry, is that it's measurable. Like, digital is measurable in a way. Let me give you a tangible example. Okay. Let's say that you develop a new video game app. Okay? You develop a new video game app, and you're going to advertise it on Facebook because you want more people to install your app, okay? And you're going to take let's just say $1,000 to buy advertising on Facebook to drive installs of your app, okay? So you buy your ads, and on the ads on Facebook and within your app, you have what they call as a pixel. It's a little piece of code. So you'll be able to tell, for that $1,000 you spent, you'll know exactly how many people installed your app. That kind of knowledge or insight was never available in the world of television or radio. And that's huge. Just the ability to measure things, because that's how you make decisions. I'm like, wow, I have to grow this business. How am I going to invest this money? Like, the ability to measure mediums is changing the entire industry, okay? And that's, I'd say, at the core of what we're talking about. It's the fundamental measurability and the constant drive by advertisers that are looking for that measurability. And so this is an acronym in our industry. These are ROAS, ROAS, Return on Ad Spend. So, all right, what did you get back for the investment that you made? And the thing about this industry, and we'll talk about it, it requires this combination of creativity and storytelling with analytics. And analytics basically means the ability to measure things. So it's this kind of collaboration of different personality types, right, that come together to create the value. So as you're thinking about it, you know, huh, maybe I would pursue a career in digital advertising. A lot of us thinking, like, am I creative? Like, is that, and it's, I'd also say it's not an either or. You kind of have to be both. These days, meaning you have to be comfortable with math. So let's say, let's go back to the example of you've created your, you know, your video game, whatever, you know, Candy Crush 9, whatever it is. You created your video game, and you come up with the ad, like, all right, here's this, you know, here's this great ad we're gonna put on Facebook, and we're gonna come up with all these different concepts. We're gonna create one that appeals to women of this particular age group. We're gonna create another one that appeals to guys, and you're coming up with all these, because you don't know, right? You're testing what's gonna work. And so even at the same time that you're creative, you have to be able to interpret the results. So my point here is math matters, right, in this world of digital advertising in a way that it didn't matter before. So return on ad spend is a very important concept. This is just making the case, like, look where the world's going. I don't have to make the case to you, you know, in terms of how many times a day you're checking your phone. Like, advertising dollars exist to reach human beings, to touch human beings, to create a response out of human beings. So if you're responsible for big advertising budgets, you have to go where the people are. And that's what's happening. So what I want to do now is I just kind of give you the overview of this big shift that's happening from traditional mediums to digital mediums. I want to tie together kind of the history of how things have evolved and came together. So in the early days, and this is, you know, starting in the early 90s, America Online, I don't know if you guys know this, but America Online was the internet. Like, it defined the internet. Like, the world that you guys live in, you know, the idea of going online, going to, did not exist. America Online is this company that I worked for starting in 1996, and they were carpet bombing the United States with CDs that looked like this. And, you know, people were creating wall art out of them. It got to be a joke during that period of time. You could not open your mailbox or open a magazine without AOL discs falling out. People were creating, you know, mosaics and with AOL discs. And the question is why? What was it at this stage in the evolution of the internet that appealed to people? And it was the first time that people could use the computer to connect with other human beings. Like, before that, the internet, I mean, your computer, like these big boxes, was basically for word processing, writing essays, but it wasn't a medium where you could actually have a social interaction. And AOL was able to package the first kind of form of that. So this is an AOL chat room. People were going online and connecting with others. And there was all sorts of different kinds of chat rooms. And parents were like freaking out because their kids were going on chat rooms. They didn't know what they were talking about. And it was a big deal. And this is the other one, instant message. Like, things that you guys take for granted every day, like, you know, direct messaging via Snapchat or whatever it is on Instagram, or just texting, like, that did not exist. And so AOL had this built in to the service. It was instant messenger. And I remember when I first started, I think it was my second day at work, my boss called me and he's like, Mike, I want to show you something. And he said, what's your screen name? I created my screen name. He's like, go back to your desk and sit down. And I went and sat at my desk, and then bling, you know, it popped up. It said, hey Mike, it's Rich. And like, that sounds like so like basic, but that was like, oh my God, it's alive, right? And my point is, that's what was really driving the growth of the internet at that time, is people started to realize, all right, this is gonna be, and people couldn't envision what would become, but it was clear that something big was happening that was gonna change the world, okay? Oh, there was even a movie made about, a big movie at the time about AOL called You've Got Mail. It's a rom-com, it's a very funny movie. But it was just to show you kind of how big AOL was in the zeitgeist at the time. So bringing it back to advertising, the topic for today, advertising at that time was, I'd say, fear-based or fear of missing out, right? Because advertisers had, and you know, marketers, if you ran a company, you're like, all right, the world is changing. What do I do about it? And so people were buying advertising just because they didn't want to be left behind, right? And they're like, all right, I have to learn about this. It wasn't a business decision. It wasn't like, all right, I'm expecting to see a return from my ad campaigns. They're like, oh, I got to do it, or I'm going to miss out. And then what ended up happening, you got to realize that during this period of time, it's what called you might have heard people refer to it, it's the dot-com bubble. This is the first bubble. So all this growth around AOL created this sense of mania, of hysteria, where investors were like funding all these different concepts, regardless of how dumb, you know, just putting millions of dollars into them, you know, pets.com, you know, who knows? There's millions of examples of these companies that people were like, all right, the world's changing, we need to invest. But what ended up happening in about 2000, it became clear that there was no business foundation for these companies to survive. They weren't earning profits, and it became clear that, like, oh my God, this is all kind of a joke. Yes, it's fun, people are communicating on AOL, but there's no business behind it, and the entire market crashed, okay? And that includes, you know, AOL stock tanked, everything in this world made a rapid run for the bottom, and the industry was confused and did not know what the future looked like. Oh, here's, see, our stock options are not totally worthless. They make great paper airplanes. So to be an employee at these kind of companies during that stage, you were compensated with stock options, and people had this illusion that they were going to get rich. Happened for a few people, not the majority of them. And overnight, like, you thought you had a lot of money on paper. Overnight, you know, the stock went down. It was worth nothing. And so it was very, very, very common. But what ended up happening, and I experienced this myself, when I was at AOL, the advertisers that we had signed up started asking us a simple question. How do I get into the search results? How do I, because here on search, people are telling you exactly what they're looking for, right? And you think about the guesswork. We started this, you know, the story about, you know, advertising has been based on guesswork, that in search, you have people raising their hand saying, this is what I'm looking for. I'm looking for new shoes. I'm looking for a new car. I'm looking for a boyfriend. I'm looking for a girlfriend. I'm looking for whatever it may be. And that was a dream to advertisers. It had never been in the history of mankind before something as an advertising medium that was so accurate. But here was the challenge. During that period of time, search results, you could not advertise in search results. The way that you guys are on Google today and you see sponsored listings versus, you know, free listings, you guys know what I'm talking about, the distinction? Yeah, you see it every day. That model had not been invented yet, and search results were supposed to be, it's the layer of algorithms, and they're like, oh, we're not going to have commercialization or advertising, but advertisers are saying that's what we want. Okay, and who can tell me the company that invented the idea or the model of advertising in search results? Any guesses? No guesses? It's not Google. People think it's Google. The vast majority of the world think it's Google, but it's actually a company out of Pasadena down here. This is a guy named Bill Gross. He had a incubator where they started a lot of different internet startups called Idea Labs, and they had this concept, which was radical during the day, called Overture. And the idea was that you could bid as an advertiser. You could choose the keywords that you wanted, and you could come up in the search results when somebody was looking at those keywords. Okay, so let's take Zappos as an example. Like, you want to bid on all what they call brand terms, like Adidas, Nike, Puma, whatever it is. You could bid on all those terms. And they created this distinction where in the inventory on the search results page, here's your paid listings versus your versus your freed listings. But here's was the challenge. Overture, they weren't a well-known destination website. Nobody knew who they were, although they had created this business model that advertisers really wanted. So what? And I was working at Overture at the time, and what they decided to do is, you know what we're going to do? We're going to go to companies that already have really big audiences and ask them to carry our search results. It's a little piece of code you're going to put on your results page. So, you know, we went to Yahoo, we went to AOL, we went to ESPN, and you got to realize, going back to the beginning, like, the industry was at a point where people were starving for a business model. The industry had just collapsed. They had no idea how they were going to make money. And so we said, all right, put this piece of code on your page, and we're going to serve the search results for you, and we're going to share the money. Okay? 50-50, we're going to share the money. And the first one that we got to try it was a company called Earthlink at the time. They were like a competitor of AOL, and it turned out to be a big bag of money, right? We had all this traffic. We then got Yahoo and AOL, and it ended up being a very big business, and it worked for everybody. It was a virtuous cycle because the advertiser got very targeted advertising. Somebody was searching for blue Adidas sneakers, and their ad came up because they had blue Adidas sneakers that they wanted to sell. And so it was a very important step in the development of digital advertising as a medium. And it was the model that would become the foundation for the entire industry. Now, for us at Overture, one of the big challenges, there was this company that had just started by a bunch of Stanford grads up in the Bay Area called Google. And there, when they started Google, their intent wasn't like, they had no idea how they were going to make money. Their goal and why they existed in the world is they wanted to create the best search engine ever. That's what was driving them. They said, we'll figure out how to make money later. Okay? So they saw what we were doing at Overture, and they copied the model. They basically said, we're going to do that. That seems to be working. They improved upon the model, and they improved upon it in a very simple way, and I'll try and explain it to you. They introduced, so in terms of the way that we did it at Overture, it was a pure auction, meaning that the highest link went to the highest bidder, meaning that if somebody's bidding on the word, you know, blue Adidas sneakers, somebody that was willing to pay a dollar for that click got served first, and then the one that was willing to pay 90 cents got served second, and so on. When Google got involved, they introduced click-through rate. Say that's a common acronym. Click-through rate is CTR, is what it's called. And it's basically the percentage of time somebody sees your ad or your search listing and clicks on the ad. So what they did is they said, all right, we're going to introduce click-through rate into the equation. So what that basically meant is that, let's say that one advertiser is bidding 50 cents, and then the other one is bidding 75 cents. But the one that's bidding 50 cents, his ad is better, and it's getting clicked on twice as many times as the one that's bidding 75 cents. Google just doubled their money, right? They're saying, all right, we're gonna put the advertiser that's bidding 50 cents first, right? Because somebody's gonna click on it twice as much, and they're gonna make a dollar. And they introduced that into the algorithm. It was a very simple and smart change, but it changed the game. The other thing that the big advantage that, because the net of the story is Google kicked our butts, you know, and there's a little footnote on the history here. But the other big advantage that Google had was, like I mentioned before, we would go out to Yahoo and AOL and ESPN and be like, let's do a partnership, carry our search results, we'll share the money 50-50. When Google came into the market, they were becoming a vacuum for searches, meaning that their algorithm and their search results kept getting better and better, so they kept getting more and more traffic. And they got to keep all the money that they were generating from Google.com. So it created this massive economic imbalance in the space. And so they would go after our customers, right? Because they were also syndicating, meaning distributing Google search results. They would go after our customers and say, we'll just give you all the money, because they didn't care. So when I first started, we were sharing 50-50. And by the end, once Google came in, they would let us keep 10% of the money. So the game was changed. Google won the war, right? The story is very clear. Now, it was a knockout punch, and it was clear very quickly that what was happening. This is the footnote, is that before Google was able to go public, they had to settle a patent infringement lawsuit with us, basically admitting that they copied what they did. Not that it matters, not that the world cares at all, but they did not invent the model that has driven their success. They basically borrowed it and iterated on it. So that was search. And at that point, when you think about the evolution of digital media in general, search was became the foundation. It was the answer to that question that we talk about, is how am I going to measure the effectiveness of my advertising? And search was it. If you were bidding on blue Adidas sneakers, you knew how many people were searching for that, how many people were clicking through to your site, and ultimately how many people were buying those sneakers. Huge, right? Historically, you could never know that information, and that's one of the things that digital has enabled, and that's why you see this massive migration of dollars to the digital mediums, which is creating opportunity for you guys. So the next phase, search, is established, and one of the things about search that was unique is it was an auction, meaning that as an advertiser, you could say, this is what I'm willing to pay based on my business for these particular clicks. And there were some very smart people that started to think, all right, how do we take the power of an auction and apply it to not just search results, but to banner advertising? You know, so the ads that you see all day, every day on your phones or on your websites, there's something called RTB. Right, and it's something that you would probably never have heard of unless you're in digital advertising, and it means real-time bidding. And so what these smart people did is they took this auction concept. These are some of the creators of real-time bidding. Right Media was eventually acquired by Yahoo. I worked for this company called OpenX. There's one called Rubicon Project. And one called AppNexus. By the way, these two are in LA. These guys are in Pasadena, and these guys are in West LA. My point is there's a lot of really, you know, people think of San Francisco and the Bay Area as the hub for digital innovation. There's actually some companies from LA that have been very instrumental in the development of the industry. Let me see. I want to break this down for you guys, just to explain to you, kind of on a daily basis, like what. Don't worry, you guys don't have to, like, understand what that says.
I'll be on file on Thursday.
Yeah, exactly. But I want to kind of break it down because you guys experience this every day. You just don't know it. Okay. So there's these things called ad exchanges that have emerged. And so on this side, you have audience. You have people that are selling advertising. Okay, think of any website that you go to or app, and you see ads. They are what they're on the audience or publisher side, and on this side are the advertisers, the people that are consuming or buying that inventory. And in between are all these different kind of middlemen or technology providers that are doing different things to enable the transaction. So the way it works. A publisher says, all right, let's say they have a certain amount of, just for example's sake, let's say they have 1 million impressions, okay? An impression is the act of somebody seeing an ad. Actually, it doesn't mean they're seeing it. It means that the ad has been served to you, right? That is called an impression. So let's say you have this finite bucket of inventory called impressions, and let's say there's a million, okay? You have a sales team, right? Your sales guys are going out, and let's stick with the shoe. Let's stick with the shoe example. So Zappos, a million impressions, and they also are selling advertising on their site. So they go to the sales guy goes to Adidas and says, "All right, we're going to sell you, 100,000 or 250,000 impressions. We're going to show your ad this many times." And Adidas says, "Okay." So if you're Zappos, you're left with, a big chunk of inventory, say 750,000 impressions. Those are opportunities to show somebody an ad, okay? And what you do, what Zappos does, they say, you know what I'm gonna do with the rest of that inventory? I'm gonna put it into an ad exchange, okay? And that's where real-time bidding comes in. And so this is also in our world called supply. These are the suppliers of advertising inventory. These are also called supply-side platforms, or SSPs. And then if you flip to the other side, this is demand, the people that are buying the inventory, that have demand for the inventory. So and this is all happening in real time. So when you're on a website, right, and an ad comes up, you guys don't realize it, but there's an auction that's taking place in microseconds behind the scenes. And the people could be bidding for you for entirely different reasons. But as a consumer, you don't really care, right? You just want to know, most of the time you don't care at all because it's an ad. But if they do it right, then you care. So they have, as an advertiser, you have all these different ways to determine who sees your ad. And that's the function that we call targeting. When people call targeting, it's determining the who. And there's so many different ways that you can do it now. So one of the primary ones, you guys probably see this all the time, retargeting. So let's go back to the shoe example. So all right, I'm in the market for new shoes. I go on Zappos, and I find these shoes that I want, and I check them out. I'm like, but I don't want to buy them because I don't have any money. Or for whatever reason, I get distracted. I get a text. And so I'm in the Zappos website, but I leave. Zappos leaves a piece of code on my browser, so they know that they know nothing about me personally, right? They don't know my name, they don't know my phone number, but they know that I'm in the market for blue Adidas sneakers. And then the next, I go out to another website. Let's say I go to, ESPN to check a sports score. Oh, look, there's an ad for blue Adidas sneakers, right? You guys see this phenomenon all the time when you're looking at something, and then it seems to follow you throughout your experience in the internet. It's called retargeting, right? And so what they're basically doing is back to this notion of reducing the amount of guesswork. They're saying, I know this person has interest, so I'm therefore going to continue to serve them. And so that's retargeting, very common, and has been revolutionary for advertisers because it just makes it so much more effective. Some people think it's annoying. If it's done right, ideally, the way that where the industry's going, it's like, all right, they didn't buy the first time. All right, now I'm going to give them an offer. I'm going to give them a discount. And then the offers would get more appealing over time. It's not quite there yet to sequence it. These are the other ways that you can target. So retargeting is one of the primary ones. Category-based targeting. So back to the Zappos example. So let's say that I want to reach sports fans or athletes. And I know that athletes tend to visit these particular websites about whatever, training or exercise or whatever the sport is. On these advertising exchanges, like here, you can choose these category bundles, right? So it's saying I want to reach women that are going to get married. Right, those are options based on, so they know based on the kind of sites that you've been visiting and your behavior that you're likely going to get married. So that's category. Geo-targeting is the where. Like let's say you only want to reach people in New York and LA, then you can set these rules as well. So ideally as a marketer, you're creating these profiles, of the who. Who are the people that are likely going to buy my product or service? Age and gender, and then device targeting as well. You can say, all right, I only want to reach people on iPhones, or I only want to reach people on iPads. So these are all options. Okay. So we've covered the who, like targeting, like how are we going to choose who we're going to show the ads to. Then the question is, how do you want to pay for them? So historically, we talked about CPM, or impressions. So that's where you're showing people, or people are paying based on how many people are going to view the ad. Then there's other models, cost per click. You can say, all right, I only want to pay per click. Yeah. Cost per lead. And all these things are happening simultaneously. So as a marketer, you can, like, let's say that, you know, back to the Zappos example, you're saying, all right, I only want to pay when somebody actually buys the shoes, okay? You can set up those kind of rules. Here's the challenge. Like, what the question is, why wouldn't everybody just do that? Because on those, to reach those kind of actions, there's only a certain amount of people where the systems can say, all right, they can guarantee you a sale. So you have to broaden your approach to reach a bigger audience to drive the result. Cost per install is a very common one these days, where if you're an app developer, you've developed a new game or a new concept, you can, on Facebook primarily is kind of the innovators around this, and Instagram, where you can go in and say, all right, I'm willing to spend X for a new install of my app. The challenge is these are very competitive markets because there's certain apps that make so much money that they can bid more than everybody else and they gobble up all the available inventory. But that's a very common one. So that is real-time bidding. Real-time bidding is, so we started with search. The next step was RTB, real-time bidding, and this is all tying it back to the migration of dollars from traditional mediums, TV, newspaper, radio, to digital mediums. These are all things that are driving that. Yes, David.
Let me articulate this. So basically, the difference between per action and maybe an install would be, for example, Pepsi. Mm-hmm. Pepsi wants to make money every time you open up a can of Pepsi.
Mm-hmm.
Versus, go back to that, John. Versus Pepsi figuring that if they lay down the concept of when I'm thirsty, I want to get Pepsi, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is that kind of what you're...
Yeah, so typically like a company like Pepsi, like there's these big, what they call brand marketers, right? You're not, in terms of selling Pepsi, it's like people aren't going to go on the internet and buy Pepsi, you know, typically and have it delivered.
So, I'm talking about influence versus actual like usage every single day.
Mm-hmm.
Like, basically, the 1,000 impressions and the per click would be, assuming a company like Zappos wants the public to be thinking about that shoe.
Yeah.
Anytime they buy a shoe.
Yeah.
And if they click on it, they're going to buy the shoe. Whereas per action would be if they, you're saying that basically that, I mean, because that's more of a micro way of doing advertising. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Is there a marker here? I'll just. Here's a way to think about it. They call this is a funnel. So they call a marketing funnel. And the way it's very common, the way that they think about it. So this is at the top level is awareness, right? And then you get it. And then here is like attention, and then decision, and then action at the bottom. And so this is what they call branded or branding advertising. You're just generating awareness for your concept. And at the bottom, this is what we call performance or direct response. Okay? And so direct response. And there's more advertisers are using different tactics across the entire funnel. Right, so there's a lot, so back to the Pepsi example, since they can't really track the action online, most of their budgets just goes into awareness, right? Telling a great story. And the metrics, meaning the kind of the ways that they have to measure the value of it, the metrics that Pepsi has around awareness are things like, all right, how many times did people click on it? How many times did people watch the video? How many likes did I get? Those are what we call upper funnel metrics versus lower funnel metrics, where you can actually say, all right, did it make my cash register ring? Okay? And so the whole point, one of the big points of the conversation is that the industry is really focusing on lower funnel metrics, right? That's where it's all trying to go, because that's where you can really understand the value of your investment, right? And so technology is trying to enable that. So hopefully that was, yes?
Would an example of action be like how Uber, why did I say that so weird? Uber, mm-hmm. How they have every person has a coupon code, and when they put that coupon code out to their friends, Uber gives that person money for to go towards a ride. Is that an
yes.
example of it?
Okay. Yes, that's exactly right. So the word action can be pretty broad. You can say, so let's say Uber wants to track redemptions on this coupon code, right? They can, on Facebook in particular, say, all right, we're willing to pay X for that particular action. So that's exactly right. Or the other thing, so my company, we used to recruit drivers for Uber, right? And they, the action for them that they defined for us was, we want applications for drivers. So everything that we did had to be measurable. Right? How many new applicants did you create for us? Okay, is that helpful? Good. Okay, so RTB. Search, RTB, and then social happens. Mark Zuckerberg has this vision for social media and the way that it can connect people like nobody before him had. Not only did he have the vision, he had the technical skills and the resources to actually build the vision. And my personal early days, people were talking about Facebook, I thought it was a joke. Most people did. It's like, okay, it's like a yearbook or something like that. But I think very few people in the early days saw what he was trying to do and what he was able to accomplish. But he's made some, as it relates to Facebook and why it's one of the most valuable companies in the world, he's made some very big innovations as it relates to digital advertising and the way that advertisers can reach people on his platforms. That's just to show you that's the growth of Facebook, and once again, advertising dollars exist to reach people. That's the only reason that the whole discipline is there. And so they have to follow the audiences. And when you see growth like this, advertisers have to say, all right, how do I do that? But if you go back to the early days when I was talking about AOL, now it's evolved to the point where it needs to come from a business decision, where it's like, all right, I'm going to show a response. And so some of the things that Scott Zuckerberg did is the way that he integrated advertising into the platform was unique. And you hear the word native a lot. And so it's what it basically means is that the advertising is integrated in a way that really looks like content. It's not like on banner advertising where it's like, oh, here's this appendage or here's this thing that I don't need to worry about. It's right in your news feed. And if it's done right, it should be content. You should be interested in it. That's the whole goal here. It's not to show you things that you don't care about or you think are annoying. It's like, all right, that's cool. I want to check it out. And so they built it right into the news feed. And the other thing about him that was, if you guys saw The Social Network, the movie, he's very patient, right? And, I mean, you can be patient when you have all the money in the world to continue to build your company without making money. But he was very patient in the way that he brought advertising into the community, because he didn't want to alienate people. And he held it off for as long as he possibly could. But when he did it, he did some very smart things. I'm going to come back to that. So one of the primary things that he did in the way that back to targeting, like thinking about the who, is they developed this concept called lookalike audiences. And lookalike audiences are, let's go back to our shoe example. Again, Adidas shoes, you're Zappos, and you're like, all right, I want to reach people that love Adidas. And you've, based on your own database, your files of people that have bought shoes before, you can say, all right, here's 5,000 people that we know love Adidas, right? This is our, and you think of that as a seed. Here's a seed audience of 5,000 people. You can go to Facebook, upload that list into Facebook, and the Facebook algorithm will say, well, you know what? We're gonna find people that look just like this, that you would never know how to target, right? And that was a big breakthrough. That was a step function. Like, how do you, you know, and the way that they architected the system made it very simple for people. You know, people talk about data, gotta leverage data all the time. But to break it down where, like, everyday people can say, all right, I know how to do that, that's what they did so brilliantly on Facebook. And it's not only can you reach lookalike audiences, you can say, all right, if you're a marketer and you have this database of people that like shoes, you say, all right, I'm gonna target those people directly and show them new styles of Adidas. So that was another kind of step function that's driving the growth of digital advertising. I want to kind of, this is another thing that's very recent. I'm going to try and break it down for you guys here. And this is about influencers on social networks and people that have audiences, right? Whether it be on Instagram or Facebook or YouTube. And there's something that's happening in the world. And let me give you another example of what this looks like. So let's go back to the shoe example, once again, okay? Just keeping it simple. So on option A, you have two ad guys. Think Mad Men. Guys work in ad agency, like, hey, we gotta come up with a really cool concept on how to sell more Adidas, okay? And they're in the room, they come up with this great new idea. On this side, you have influencer networks, okay? So you're saying, all right, we're going to ask people, you know, that you're let's say you're Zappos once again, and we're gonna ask people that we know like Adidas, to submit a video saying, this is why I love Adidas kicks, you know, and they submit a video talking about, you know, who they are, bringing personality to it. And what ends up happening, and the reason this really matters, and the way the old world worked, is the advertising guys was the only option. Like, you're gonna buy media, you're gonna buy, when I say media, I mean advertising, by the way, like buying advertising. The guys in the room try this, and they get a particular result. But the influencers, they have a built-in audience, right? That's basically free advertising. Right, for Adidas, because these people are like, hey, check out my new video for Adidas. So you're basically getting that, they're boosting that organically to YouTube, to Facebook, to Instagram. Now that's one of the key points. So you get this free distribution by working with influencers, but what's even more relevant is that the way that the Facebook system is designed, like, Facebook wants you to use Facebook, right? They want you to engage with content that is on Facebook. Whether it's advertising or whether it's user-generated content, things that you've created, Facebook doesn't care. And so the way that they reward advertisers who have used when I say creative, it means the actual assets like the video or the picture. If you have a piece of creative work that has a baseline of organic engagement, you know, compared to the ad guys in the room who have zero, you can actually buy advertising for exponentially less money, right? People don't realize that, right, in the world right now. So that's like, that's where it's going. Like, in terms of and it also plays to like the millennial generation, and you know, you guys want authenticity. Like, you don't want polished, you know, highly produced things. Like, and we see it in the response. People respond to things that are real, and that's what's happening. And I'll break it down for you here. This is an example. This is a whiskey product, Hennessy's. And they did, this is the traditional model versus the influencer model. This is a platform called Create It that brings influencers in to try new creative concepts. So this one, it took them 120 days to basically shoot this video, right? Come up with all the concept. It cost them $1 million, and they reached they had a 0.1% engagement metric. That means that of the people that saw the ad or saw this particular piece of work, 0.1% engaged with it. You know, 1,000 people. On this side, and this is the influencers, this is like the other term that you'll hear is crowdsourcing. And this is a crowdsourced campaign. So these guys came in and they did it. They created a video for Hennessy's. It only took them 30 days. The whole thing cost $100,000, and the reach was 10x. That's 100x, actually, between the two. So I'm just kind of illustrating, like, all right, this is the direction that the world is going. So, you know, people think, you know, like, you know, I'll minimize my kids when they're using, you know, social networks. And, you know, in terms of, like, you're going to waste your time with that, but it's driving business. Like, this is really impacting the future of the world in a big way. The other thing is, as I'm talking about these things, each of these different disciplines that I'm talking about, social, search, RTB, they all have these crazy ecosystems that spring up around them. The point that I'm bringing is that there's so many different unique kind of job opportunities and companies that exist that you might not know are there unless you know where to look, okay? And there's a number of them. This is called a Lumascape, and there's about 8 of them that break down the different parts of the industry. So just back to social, there's 2 platforms that matter from at this point. From an advertiser's perspective, if you're saying, all right, you know, I have to think about, you know, where I'm going to spend my time is important, not just my money, but my time learning how my brand or my product behaves, you're starting with Facebook and Instagram. And you guys know they're the same company. Facebook owns Instagram. And if you're an advertiser and you're buying ads, you're going into the dashboard, you basically can just click a box and get Instagram at the same time. It's all integrated into the same flow. Then you have Twitter, obviously, less relevant, at least from my perspective. You know, they don't have the same size and scale. In terms of creating conversation, it can be valuable. Pinterest as well. Does anybody in here use Pinterest? Yeah, a little bit? Yeah. So in terms of, you know, reaching females, and it has high commercial intent, meaning people are using it to organize products and services that they like. So that's definitely a relevant platform. And then this is the big question mark in the world right now as it relates to advertising, and that's Snapchat. For how many of you is Snapchat your social network of choice? Really?
I love it.
Well, let me try this. Like, how about Facebook? Like, how many? Facebook?
Yeah.
Okay, got it.
Instagram.
I wish I could have done like a little survey. So, would you say if you're going to rank your social networks, how many is do you use Instagram the most of all the others? Got it. Okay, and then Snapchat. Also, got it. My kids, I have a 13-year-old boy and a 11-year-old daughter, and they're like Snapchat all day, every day. And like, they won't consider Facebook because it's not cool, because I'm on it. they want nothing to do, yes.
Twitter dominates right now, like our demographic.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh.
It's fast, it's like the news feed is always flowing.
Huh, interesting.
But like you said, how it's not really. Well, it kind of creates a conversation, but it's not as, like, you can't say as much.
On Twitter?
On Twitter.
Yeah.
I think that's part of the reason people like it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds weird, but it's like they like that it's just super vague and short, and then you get to assume whatever you want to assume about whoever posted what.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Subtweeting is huge, you know, so everybody's obsessed with it.
Subtweeting?
Yeah.
What's that?
Talking about somebody else in a tweet.
Without actually,
like you don't say their name or you say like the thing, but you just like, wow, I hate it when girls do this. And then, uh-huh. like the person before you like just said exactly what you don't like. Uh-huh. You know, like it's one of those things where you get to assume whatever you want.
But in terms of Twitter, are you guys typically engaging with like your people you already know, or are you also, you know, tweeting on more like around TV shows or with celebrities and that kind of stuff?
Well, you can quote and retweet, so like you see everybody else's interests come into yours.
Huh.
So you can interact with everything else.
Yeah. It's really interesting. I wouldn't know, you know, because I mean, for me, like, I think Twitter's not an easy platform. Like, in terms of like really learning how to get a lot out of it, it seems like the learning curve's hard, but I wouldn't have expected you guys to be as bullish on Twitter. It's kind of cool. All right, so what else? Oh, so in terms of what's next, in terms of, you know, we've talked about these step functions, these major things that are impacting the industry. The next one we think is OTT or over the top. She's asleep. It's okay. What's that? But over the top, and you guys are, you know, especially with kind of the younger generation, you guys are not, you know, in the data shows, like not signing up for, unless your parents have it, like signing up for cable. Like you don't necessarily need DirecTV or, you know, Time Warner cable. And all of these different platforms are disrupting the traditional flow of television advertising. It's also, you guys heard the term cord cutting. It's happening in droves right now, where you're just going to end up subscribing to these different platforms. And these are digital, right? Meaning if you go back to the whole point of this conversation, it's about being able to measure. Right, so if you're, you know Adidas and, you know, advertising on Netflix or Hulu, the kind of information and tracking that these platforms are going to be able to provide to you to validate your return on your ad spend are like eons beyond what like DirecTV or, you know, the traditional broadcast networks. And so we think like this is really the next phase of growth. Ultimately, traditional is going away. You know, who knows how long it's going to take, but like the traditional forms of consumption are going to die, and then these new platforms are going to thrive and prosper. Okay, so how much time do we have left, Dave?
15 minutes.
Okay. Yeah, let's talk a little bit about career paths. So I've talked like very kind of high level about what's going on in digital media, and I'll try and break it down. And if you're like thinking, all right, what do I want to do with my life? You know, what are the different directions that you can go? The different kind of roles or functions that that exist in digital media. So these are the primary tracks, and I'll break each one down: sales, business development, marketing, and content marketing is a huge one. That's part of that. Account management, ad operations, and analytics. So sales and business development, and this is the track that I took when I was about your age. I needed a job, applied for this, you know, job off of a print advertisement, and they said, you know, we appreciate your enthusiasm. You're not qualified to be the general manager, but you'll, but we will give you a job in sales, and I took it, and it's a. You know, you guys know the function. It's really, you know, being willing to reach out to people. You want to be an extrovert. You have to develop a thick skin. You really want to be tenacious, because in terms of, you know, and by the way, sales and business development, like if you guys are on job boards, typically means the same thing. And people use the language in different ways. So you're going to want to, you know, clarify what they mean, what the job is. But typically, they mean the same thing. The other thing is traditional sales is dying from the standpoint of cold calling. Like, it just doesn't work anymore. People are inundated with different forms of marketing. So salespeople are basically forced to become their own marketers, right? Their own content marketers. And let me try and break it down for you a little bit. So let's say that you get a job selling advertising for Facebook. And you know, your role, your responsibility is to call on the car dealers. Say it's the car dealers, right? And so your job is to tell stories about how, like, kind of the stuff that I'm doing here, where you're saying, all right, this is what's in it for you as a car dealer, and you're posting things to your social media about your world, and you're generating interest, right? It's not typically just cold calling, right? People don't have time for that anymore. And it's also just the same kind of mindset of measuring response. Okay, I put this out, or I sent out X number of emails, how many responses do I get? So people in sales and business development are basically becoming their own marketers, and they're having to leverage technology for themselves, things like Salesforce or platforms. But this is, you know, if you don't know what you want to do with your life, but you like talking to people, and you have a thick skin, you can take rejection, you don't take it personally, I think it's a great career path, because you can make a lot of money, and you can learn so much. It's not for everybody, and you have to know that about yourself. But all of, if you go back to like this slide here, like, all of these companies have sales functions. They need help, right? They need help for people to capture their story and go out and tell it. So that's sale. The other thing is there's, you know, lack of income certainty, meaning like you don't know how much you're going to make, right? But that's also what's exciting about it too, is you get that, like, that the excitement of the deal. Right, and so some people really, really thrive on it. It's also highly measurable. You know if you're not doing it. So it's takes a certain personality type. But, you know, I think what's at the core of it is really, you know, wanting to help is a lot of it, and then also just that willingness to get out there and take a swing of the bat. Marketing is another just great function, and it should say content marketing, just because in this world of social storytelling, and you can take it to Twitter, the way that you talk on Twitter versus the way that you post on Instagram versus Facebook. These are all, you interact with different social platforms in different ways, and so developing those skill sets and understanding that on behalf of your company is a really valuable thing to consider. And that is, in my mind, it starts with a writing function, like creative. Like, all right, how are we going to tell this story? What does it look like? What is the picture going to look like? What is the video that we envision? But the point is, one of the points I want to make is that it's not just the creative and storytelling component. There has to be a math component too. Because at the end of the day, you want to see with the ideas that you came up with, what your team, how did they do in the real world, right? You need to be able to understand the data, like how many clicks did you get? How many sales did you generate? So marketing is becoming this really hybrid of math and quantitative skills with creative skills. And it's also a competitive advantage that your generation has, right? Versus like the old dogs in the space. You guys are natives to this. You understand it in ways that we don't, and you guys should leverage that. These are the salary ranges. These are some of the titles that you'll see: marketing manager, marketing director, brand manager, marketing associate. And then moving on, account manager. This is also in terms of a account management, in terms of a career path, in terms of what your things to consider. If you're somebody, you're like, you know, I'm not a salesperson. I don't want that pressure. I don't want that spotlight. I don't like the rejection. I don't want it. But at the same time, you like the industry, you like people, and you really want to help. Account management is a great career track. And a lot of, in my opinion, in my world, this is the heart of the organization, right? So if you sign up a new advertiser, go back to the car dealer example, to advertise on Facebook, his primary point of contact at Facebook is going to be this account manager. Right? And so they're really defining when they have questions, how am I doing? Help me understand, you know, what else we should be considering. The account manager is that resource to them. So you have to really like the product. You want to get, you know, in the weeds, and you become like the expert. And it's a really, really important role. So these are, you know, you love to help and deliver. You're highly responsive. You know, you're defining that customer experience for your clients. The titles are account manager, media strategist, and media analyst. And these are some of the salary ranges. And they can obviously, you know, you get more experience, go up from there. This is a really kind of new, somewhat new role that's really been evolving a lot. And they're historically have been called ad operations. Now they're being referred to as traders. And when you go back to the whole RTB, real-time bidding, component of this conversation, where we're talking about these auctions, the traders, you think of like somebody on Wall Street, right? You think somebody that really has kind of a math orientation that's looking at the trends in the data. That's what ad ops and traders do, because they're determining where the money should be spent, and it's becoming an increasingly important function as auctions become more and more central to the world of digital advertising. When we recruit, like we're starting to recruit for these kinds of roles, and at first I was like, you know what, I want somebody with a background in digital advertising. And I've been having some conversation recently, that's not what I want. What we want, somebody that's just smart, with a blank slate, likes math, right, is comfortable in it, and can learn, that comes at things more from like a financial perspective. And I'd say that that's becoming more common. Like, you don't need the experience to bring to the table if you have the right attitude and willingness to learn. Because a lot of the, like, we want to train people. Like, all of these platforms have these training modules, and we don't want people to come in with bias, that they understand how the world works. You got to come in with an open mind. And so this is a really interesting role, and it's very, very math driven, if that's what you like and that's what you're comfortable with. And the next kind of level of this is people that are in analytics. And the term analytics you'll hear a lot, but it basically means people that are responsible for measurement. And it's measurement plus insights, right? So it's determining, all right, how are we going to measure the effectiveness of this campaign, and how are we going to interpret the results? And these are people that are in analytics, and they're driving, there's a lot of correlations that they're looking at, like, oh, this campaign with this creative, we see very high, for example, cost per install rate. Let's pay attention over here. And this kind of thinking is becoming very, very important. The salary ranges on that one, it really depends, you know, based on the company, you know, and kind of where you're coming from. And so that's it. That's what I got for you guys today.
I raised this earlier.
Yes.
Today, you were one STEM.
Mm-hmm.
At UCSB, at Cal Show, right? And did you see yourself doing something like this when you were in a college class? What can they be doing in general?
Mm-hmm.
You know, while they're in this experience here, or their 4-year school they're going on to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thinking about succeeding.
Yep. So this, what I do, like, it didn't exist when I was in your seat. Like, and I could not have been like, oh, I want to be in digital advertising, because truly digital advertising didn't exist. What helped me was understanding, like when AOL came out, they like I had a sense of like, oh, that's going to be big. That's important, the way that people are interacting. So I would say pay attention to that instinct that you guys have. Like when you see apps or new things that come out and you're like, holy crap, that is cool. I'd never thought of that. I really like that. That instinct matters. And you guys can work at those companies. Think that you can. You can. Because that's, you know, back to this notion of selling, like putting it out there, saying, you know, you see an app that you really love. And you're like, you want to get into this space of digital. Go do the research. Go on LinkedIn. Go on Crunchbase. Find out who they are. Send them a note. Tell them you love their app. And if you have ideas, say, this is what I see for you. Try this on, right? And that's how things happen in the world, right? It's not like, you know, waiting, you know, and just applying through a linear job listing. It's creating something or seeing something that you like and you believe in and going for it and keep doing that, right? Because that's like, I didn't know, like responding to this ad in the LA Times that I'd be here 25 years later saying, hey, I've spent my entire, you know, life thinking about these kinds of things now. But those kinds of opportunities are there for you. You can't see them yet. But it starts with the instinct of what you like. What you think is important in the world. So I would say chase that stuff. So cool. I'm available for any questions or yes.
For those companies that you showed earlier,
yeah.
Do they offer stuff like internship opportunities and like positions?
100%. You know that, and that's the, even if they don't, tell them that you want to be the intern. You know, some of them, like, you got to realize a lot of startups, like, you might have this perception that, like, they're organized and they know what they're doing. They don't. So it's like they might not have a structured intern program. But if you're like, hey, I want to help, and I want to help for free because you're just about learning, like, offer those kinds of things, and the doors will open for you. Some of them have structured internship programs, but everybody wants help. Right, everybody needs help, especially if you're bringing something unique to the table. Like you've given it thought, you have a point of view or a perspective on their product, and offer that. I'll tell a quick story in closing here. When I was working at OpenX, let me go back. I was working at OpenX, this company right here. You'll see where they are in the ecosystem. OpenX, a little guy right there. So when I was working at OpenX, this guy named Ari Oberman, my friend's like, oh, you gotta talk to Ari. He needs a job and he's smart and you like him. And so Ari came in. He had zero background in digital advertising. And he's like, I really want to work here. And I'm like, I didn't have any jobs available. And I'm like, you know, I appreciate it. We don't have anything right now. And he kept on me. He kept on me. We had a ping pong table. He really wanted to play ping pong at OpenX. And so he came back and he like challenged me to a ping pong game. We played, whatever. But the point is, he stayed on me. And I eventually said, you know what? I'm going to give you a shot. And he said, I'll work for free. And I said, I don't want you to work for free. That's not right. I'll pay you $1,000 a month. So he came on, and I said, pay him $1,000 a month, and he was just like a sponge, you know, learning everything. And he ended up being the best sales guy that the company had ever hired. Like his second year, he made $300,000 in a year. He broke the entire comp model. We had to fix it. But the point is that the point was that he just went for it. Like, he didn't care. He's like, I want to work here. That kind of enthusiasm, that energy, that you're like, hey, this isn't just another job. It's like, I care about what you're doing, and I want to be on the team. Those kind of things move people. So if I was going to leave you with one kind of thought, when you see that, go for it. Take the swing. Cool? Thanks, you guys.
Thank you.
Yeah.